history with Nancy goes back to the mid-1960s when she and Bob and I and a lot of others were part of the exciting moment when conceptual art and earthworks in all of their varied guises were emerging from minimalism. Although never a conceptual artist per se, Holt's first group show was the Dewan Gallery's Language 3. She varied concrete poetry and landscapes, made some wonderful artist books, and in 1966, when I curated Eccentric Abstraction, she made a crossword puzzle about it. And that was my first sort of clue to her peculiar approach to art and life. Back then, I have to admit that I spent more time arguing with Bob than talking to Nancy. She was no shrinking violet, but it's clear in hindsight that she was figuring out where she was going. And I only really got to know her some 30 years later when she moved to Galisteo, New Mexico, where I've lived for 25 years. Just before Bob's death in 1972, I recall Nancy talking excitedly about her own work. While by then was beginning to attract attention, I was touched to read Virginia Dewan's memory that Bob said, "Now it's Nancy's turn." They were married for only 10 years when his plane crashed. As a feminist, I always found it ironic that she stayed behind that day to work on her own work, to concentrate on her own work. After Smithson's death, Holt entered the large-scale earthworks public art field in which he had left a big hole, so to speak. Despite plenty of other candidates, she became the only, the only woman to enter the land art pantheon, an admired if contested token. Artist Sandra Perry recently mounted an email sign in the Western landscape that read, "I make land art now. Put me in all your white male Nancy Holt land art shows." In 1974, Nancy made Hydra's Head at Art Park, her first major connection between earth and sky, and one of my all-time favorite pieces. My then partner Charles Simmons and I went on a pilgrimage to Amarillo Ranch after Bob's death. Nancy and I talked about that when she was in the hospital in Santa Fe, desperately trying to finish editing the Ram film for Bob's Dallas show. The last of her endless contributions to his memory, and of course, she succeeded. She While Nancy felt she and Bob were both New Jersey limbo types, she said she immediately felt at home on her first trip west in 1968. So it was exciting when she called in 95 to see how I liked New Mexico because she was thinking of moving there. When she got her own place, she delighted in every new tchotchka or bit of furniture, however ordinary. She got a huge amount of pleasure out of stuff, as she did from new friends. I'm wearing a pin of hers, just for this occasion. Her enthusiasm extended to New Mexico itself. We had a fine old time exploring our state, from hiding in the bushes at dawn to watch the flights of sandhill cranes at the Bosque de la Pache, to squabbling over a bench at the Sasuke flea market, and hanging out with Phil Glass at the opening of the Dewan Light Sanctuary. We heard a Galisteo guru claim that our whole basin was underlaid by crystals, which wasn't true, but it had to resonate with Smithson's mate. I once said that Bob would have gotten a kick out of our being so close, and she said he was too far away to care, and if I'd been nicer to him, he'd have given me some art and I'd be better off. Nancy had a quiet, offbeat sense of humor and could be marvelously spontaneous. She faced tragedy and adversity since childhood with remarkable calm, and I never saw her visibly angry. We were not always on the same page about politics, and we rarely talked about art. But like siblings, the parallels in our past lives informed our long friendship. We had, in a sense, come up together. Our interests continued to intersect in odd ways, from artist books to adobe building. Roundness was the prime vehicle through which Nancy's preoccupation with connecting earth and sky, time, sight, and perception was manifested. Roundness was her signature forma. All Holt's public works are tools for seeing. Viewers don't look at them and through them to discover other realms. Her tunnel vision focused land and cityscapes apparently too vast to be seen, implying the eye is a hole in the body and connecting the body to environment and vice versa. Nancy liked Emily Dickinson, and especially this quote, "The outer from the inner derives its magnitude." Beginning in the mid-1990s, I started nagging Nancy about getting a book done. I found it really odd that she was genuinely uninterested. Despite a large bibliography and exhibition record and reputation, there was not even a decent catalog on her work until Alina Williams finally persuaded her to collaborate on Sightlines, which appeared not a moment too soon in 2011. I never got to say a real goodbye to Nancy. I was stupidly optimistic that she would return from New York when she was helicoptered there for experimental treatment. But now I keep recalling the long, solemn gaze we exchanged as she was leaving New Mexico for a much greater journey. I think she knew. In 2000, Nancy's beloved and loquacious cat, Karuna, was found on the side of the road by writer Rebecca Solnit, who was staying at my house. She recalled the white kitten emerging from the aftermath of a thunderstorm. It was the anniversary of Bob's death, and Nancy took Karuna in. She was fascinated by synchronicity, but her death was decidedly untimely.